Greetings to all of our family and friends. Thanks for joining us today. This is the day the Lord has made, so we will rejoice and be glad in it. Listen, I wanted to come on and make sure that as we prepare ourselves for this worship experience, I want you to make sure you do two things, as I always ask. First thing is, I want you to make sure you share this live experience. And the second thing is, I want you to share some love as you're coming in. I want you to make sure that you just simply click the share button, share with everybody that you're connected to, or let them know that God is about to do something absolutely awesome on your behalf. Share with all your friends, all your family, because they do not want to miss this. And then share some love as you're coming in. Speak to those who are coming in as well, and make sure they know that you have high expectations for what God is going to do on today, and you're glad to be worshiping with them on today. Listen, I wanted to make sure that I take this time to extend my thanks on behalf of me and my family, as those of you who have shown care and concern during the loss of my father, Wesley Hazel Sr. This has been a rough time, but we thank you for every call, all the cards, all the condolences, and your contributions. We don't take it lightly, nor do we take it for granted. So thank you all from the bottom of my heart for all that you've done, and continue to pray for us as we go through this season of bereavement and grief. Listen, we are ready for what God is going to do. So we're going to take you into the tabernacle as we prepare ourselves for praise and worship. And the word, thank you for being a friend. God bless you. So good. Hello to everybody. We are grateful for you being here. I want you, if you will, to grab your Bible, grab your smart device. I want you to grab your notepad and your paper. Get ready for what God is going to do on today. And I want you to turn with me to Job chapter 42, beginning at verse 10. Job 42, verse 10. I have began a series entitled Believe It or Not. If you are believing God for anything, I want you to hold on to that belief and know that if God said it, he's going to do it. So I want you to make sure that your belief system is where it needs to be based on what God is going to do in your life. Job chapter 42, verse 10 simply says these words. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he had prayed for his friends. And the Lord gave Job twice as much for his trouble. Amen. I want to preach from the subject today. Thank you for being a friend. Thank you for being a friend. Is there anybody that can testify that you have prayed more in this last 2 years than you have in your entire life? Anybody can testify that you have had your relationship with God stretched in such a way that you have, in fact, began to call on God more than you ever have before. Is there anybody that can testify that your prayer life has increased based on all of the things that we've been through, all the uncertainties, all of the ups and the downs, all the trials and tribulations? God has been on speed dial for us, because if we ever needed God before, we sure do need him now, right now. And I don't know about you, but I'm grateful that every now and then we can still have a little talk with Jesus and tell him all about our troubles. He can hear our faintest cry and he'll answer by and by. When we think about our prayer life, sometimes it requires trouble pushing us to the place where we talk to God more. I hate to admit it, and I know you do too, but sometimes we don't pray until trouble hits our house. Sometimes we don't talk to God the way we should until sickness enters your body. You don't talk to God the way you should until things happen in your life that bring you literally to your knees. It is while on your knees that you find yourself in a place where we recognize that I need God. Is there anybody that can testify on your chat and just simply say, I need God like I've never needed him before? Somebody who's watching right now ought to type in the chat, because watch this. When I think about how many times we've been through some ups and some downs, oftentimes, if we'll be honest, when things were good, we don't talk to God. When we have our bills are paid, we don't talk to God like we should. When our children are doing what they're supposed to do, we don't talk to God like we should. So therefore, we almost become self-dependent. We become self-sufficient. We depend on ourselves. So therefore, what do we need God for? So every now and then, God has to disturb our peace in order to get our attention. Sometimes God has to allow some things to happen so that we can get back to the place where we learn how to call on his name. And many times, especially in church, we shout over stuff we never gonna get. Why? Because a lot of times we just want God to give us a blessing. We make claims that God's got a blessing with my name on it. And that sounds good, but at the end of the day, I believe that you gotta understand that to whom much is given, much is required. Yes, I'm almost there, because when you think about how many times we've gone through life as if you don't need the Lord, sometimes he got to pull you by your coattail. This is the essence of the story of Job. Job is a story of a man who was upright. He was righteous. He eschewed evil, and he did right in the sight of God all the time. He was a righteous man who prayed for his children. Job had multiple businesses. Job had great land and great houses. Job had everything a man could want and a wonderful relationship with God. But it was that when it was Job was finding himself in the comfort of his life, things became uncomfortable. Might I suggest to you that sometimes it takes us being put outside of our comfort zone for us to really get back to our relationship with God. The Bible says that God is having a heavenly council meeting, and the devil comes in as part of God's plan. And he says, hey, what are you doing here? And he says, I'm seeking to whom I may devour. And the Lord says, have you considered Job? And might I pause here and say to somebody who's watching, it's a wonderful thing to be considered by God. Because what that suggests is God knows what you're made of. God knows how much you can bear and how much you can also handle. He said, you can do anything you want to him, just don't touch his soul. And so it is that when it is that God wants to increase your prayer life, increase your belief system in him, and oftentimes make life uncomfortable to the point where you start believing God, that only God can do some things in your life, that's when we find in Job chapter 1 that sometimes, even when you're saved, even when you are righteous, even when you do right, every now and then, what will push you into prayer is whenever you're faced with unfortunate facts. Yeah, somebody would help me with this. Sometimes, as a believer, I want us to understand that you're going to be faced
with some unfortunate facts. When it is, Job is going by his regular day, Job is met with messengers. And one messenger comes and says, hey, Job, the camel that you had, they came and they took all the camel that you had. And I alone escaped to tell it. And then another one came and said, hey, Job, I hate to tell you, but those sheep that you had for your business, they came and killed all the sheep and I escaped alone and I'm the only one that made it out. And then another one came and said, Job, the land that you had and the houses that you had, they're all gone. And one by one, and while he was yet speaking, another one came and says, those children that you were praying for every day, they were eating, drinking, and being merry in the house. And a windstorm came and destroyed the house, killing all of your children. Yes, brothers and sisters, sometimes as saved as you are, as wonderful as you are, and as righteous as you are, sometimes you're going to be faced with unfortunate facts. Anybody a witness that's watching, can you remember some times where it seemed like if it wasn't one thing, it was another? It seemed like one family member got sick and another one went through some things, and it seemed like your car broke down and then you lost your job. And if it's not one thing, it's another. And sometimes we have to ask, we even ask the question, Lord, why is this happening to me? But you got to understand, the Bible says that many are the afflictions of the righteous. Yes, I want to mess your theology up, because you think because you saved, you're not going to go through nothing. But the Bible suggests that if you are saved, if you are righteous, then what you can expect to have is many afflictions. Yeah, you can expect to go through some things, but the problem is you think you're going through it by yourself. But can somebody witness and testify that as long as I get God on my side, if God be for me, who can be against me? Greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. What will lead us back to prayer, what will strengthen your relationship with God, is when you are faced with some unfortunate facts. When you're faced with unfortunate facts, there's some people who are watching who you've been faced with some unfortunate facts this week. There's been some bad news that you've received, and it makes you almost question some things. But what Job says to us, he says that I want you to know that the Lord gives and the Lord is who takes away. Sometimes the right perspective helps you deal with unfortunate facts. You got to recognize that everything I have belongs to God. Is there anybody that can testify that when I'm faced with unfortunate facts, it ought to lead me back to God? It ought to lead me back to God. But not only will unfortunate facts bring you closer to God and make you pray more than you ever have, but this is something else that you may have faced. Y'all ready for this? Sometimes when we are dealing with unfiltered family and friends, unfiltered family and friends will make you will make you pray. Yeah, when you are dealing with family members and friends who are unfiltered. Watch this. Job is going through all these things, and his wife, as he is experiencing now sickness and boils are all over his body. They have lost everything. And Job's wife says to Job, Job, why don't you just curse God and die? Yeah, just curse God and die. Why are you dealing with all this? Just curse God and die. And you got to be careful, because nothing takes the filter off people like trouble. Yeah. Facebook and Instagram has this feature where they can take your picture, and no matter how many blemishes and spots you have on it, no matter how flawed you may be, they have a filter, watch this, that makes you look more beautiful than you really are. Yeah. And sometimes there are people who can live with you, people who are related to you, who can be filtered, watch this, until trouble comes and you find out who they really are. Anybody know that sometimes trouble, will take the filter off people? And my problem with this whole situation and conversation between Job's wife and Job is, if Job lost everything, then she lost everything. Yeah, y'all not talking to me. If Job lost his children, she lost her children. So my question to Job's wife is, hey wifey, why should I curse God and die? If we both lost everything, why should I do it? But watch this. What you have to remember is, Satan said to God, if you take everything from him, if you take the hedge of protection off of him, then Job will curse God and die. The language that she uses is the language of the devil. Now, let me suggest to you that just like God can use anybody, so can the devil. That's why you got to be careful that when the filter comes off, sometimes you will recognize that God, that just like God uses you, God can, the enemy can also use those who are closest to you. And watch this. And when the filter comes off, you got to know where you stand. He says, woman, you sound foolish. Should we accept the good and not the bad? Should we accept all these things that God has blessed us with and then turn on God? Watch this. He says, you got to know that we got to learn how to say, in spite of everything we've lost, blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, wonder, is there anybody that can still bless the name of the Lord? Yeah, even in bad times, even when you have faced some unfortunate facts and you've dealt with unfiltered family, you still got to say, I will bless the Lord at all times. Now, that sounds cute. That's a good saying. But watch this. You can't say I'm going to bless him at all times until you go through all things. Yeah, no. So you can't testify about blessing him at all times if you haven't gone through hard times. You can't talk about it if only thing you had is good times. But when it is, you can still bless God in the face of unfiltered family. That's when you know my prayer life is getting stronger. That's when God knows that I can trust you because you didn't give up when your family became unfiltered. But not only was his family unfiltered, but so were his friends. His friends, upon hearing what Job is going through, they come and they sit with Job. They sit with Job for a week. They sit with him and they don't say nothing. And many times, might I suggest to you that if you don't know what to say, don't say nothing at all. Yeah, that's my mama taught me a long time ago. If you ain't got nothing nice to say, don't say nothing at all. It is when Job's friends finally open their mouth that their filter comes off. Yeah, the filter comes off. Because then one by one, they start accusing Job of doing something. Because, you know, there's some people who you're connected to that low key have been side eyeing you the whole time. Yeah, you can't be that saved. You can't be that perfect. Surely something is wrong with you. And so his friends one by one started accusing Job. Job, it must be something that you did wrong. It must be something that you did in the past. Why would the Lord that you serve do all this to you? And Job's friends, all of a sudden, they start accusing him one by one. And as Job is going through his own tumultuous time, one by one, they start saying, well, Job, maybe it's for some past sins. Maybe when we used to go to the club, maybe that's catching up to you. Maybe when you did that person wrong, maybe that's what did it. Maybe when you were testing lying on Facebook, maybe that's what's going on. And many times there are people who've been watching your every move, watch this, and can regurgitate everything you did. Why? Because the filter has come off. And again, nothing removes the filter like trouble. Yeah. Some people have been waiting on your downfall. There was a few months ago, there was on Facebook this thing called the Crate Challenge. Yeah, there's a thing called Crate Challenge where they take milk crates. Y'all remember old school milk crates? Now, people don't even drink milk nowadays. But now, all of a sudden, we found 50 milk crates. And the Milk Crate Challenge was when they stacked these crates up. And the object of it was to see if you can climb up the milk crates without falling off. And so these people, I'll just keep it at these people. These people were crazy enough to take this challenge. Watch this. And then the crowd would gather around them. Watch this, with phones in hand to record the whole situation. Why? Not because they believed you can make it, but they wanted to watch you fall. Now, might I suggest to you, you are connected to some people. You may have been friends for a long time. You may have gone to school together. You may have even grown up together. But there are some people who, when the filter comes off, what you'll recognize is they've been just waiting for you to fall this whole time. They've been waiting on the opportunity for you to be less than perfect. And so Job's friends, one by one, start questioning Job. What do you do when everybody connected to you makes you feel worse about what you're going through? What do you do? And so Job then goes to the only thing he knows to do. He starts praying to God. But Job starts praying to God and say, God, now, you shouldn't allow me to go through all this. Why would you allow me to go through all this stuff? And Job is frustrated. And then, we used to say, now, I want to have the patience of Job, but if you read your Bible, Job really wasn't that patient. Job had some questions, as we all would, because we're faced with some unfortunate facts and dealing with unfiltered friends and family. Job has some questions. And if we be honest, Job's questions lead us to where the point of the text is, because the Bible says that when Job got through, God turned around and asked Job, where were you when I hung the sun in the sky? Where were you, Job, when I made grass green and I made it grow on contact? God says to Job, where were you when I made the cows to bring milk? Where were you when I made the hens to give eggs? Where were you, Job, when I parted the seas and I created the mountains? Job, were you there? No, you weren't there. In other words, God says, you can't question my understanding when you don't even understand who I am. There's somebody who's watching right now that watches. We used to say that our thoughts are not his thoughts and our ways are not his ways. And that's true, because what you got to understand is you can't even in your feeble mind think of what God has in store for you. But what you can appreciate and celebrate even on today is that all things work together for the good of them that love God. Let me pause here and say to you that whatever you may be going through, whether it's good or bad, it's all working for your good. And so here it is. So Job is frustrated. God is frustrated. But then God turns and starts condemning Job's friends. Yeah, he starts condemning Job's friends, because it's not that you went against Job that's the problem. No. It is that you start putting my name in your mouth. Yeah, you was fine as long as you asked Job what he did. It is when you start saying maybe God is punishing you, when you start trying to justify and put words in the Lord's mouth, God says, I need to deal with you, not just on behalf of my servant Job, but because you ain't put no respect on my name. Yeah, you got to be careful when you talk about what God is doing and what God is not doing. You got to be careful when you try to act like you got the mind of God. And God deals with his friends and says, listen, I don't even know what I'm going to do with you. The only thing I can think of is that you need to offer some sacrifices. And even then, I might still have to consider what I'm going to do with you, because I don't play when it comes to that. And so the Bible says that in our text, Job chapter 42, verse 10, that the thing we used to shout about is that the Lord gave Job double for his trouble. That's good. That's good. But before we get to the double for his trouble, the Bible says that the only reason that the Lord turned the captivity of Job was when, y'all ready for this? Job prayed for his friends. Woo. Here's the point of the text. I want you to get this. And so in order for Job to get the blessing he was searching for, he had to balance between unforgiveness and faith. Is there anybody that can testify you've been there where people have done you wrong and you had to balance between dealing with your own unforgiveness and dealing with the faith that you're supposed to have? Yeah, this is where that belief system comes in, because if you believe God's word, if you understand God's word, you got to understand that the Lord commands us to forgive. But forgiveness is easier said than done. Yeah, forgiveness is easier said than done. And might I suggest to you that when it comes to forgiveness, forgiveness is not natural. Did y'all hear that? Forgiveness is not natural because you don't naturally forgive people. Yeah, you steal from me. I promise you, I ain't got forgiveness in me. You take my stuff. I promise you that forgiveness ain't the first thing that comes to my mind. If you kill my child, I promise you, forgiveness is not in my vocabulary. No, not at all. But forgiveness is not natural, but it is supernatural. So if I'm going to forgive, it requires dependence on God. So while I'm going between unforgiveness and my faith, it is, I don't want to forgive them, but I got to forgive them. And when you recognize that true forgiveness is not even about them. Yeah, when you forgive, it don't make them feel better. Forgiveness makes you feel better. Forgiveness, the way it works is sometimes you have to forgive people, watch this, who never gave an apology. I wish I had some witnesses that can type it even right now. It's sometimes you got to be willing to forgive people who will never give an apology. There's some people that you got to release them, watch this, so that you can move on with your life. There's some people that you got to let that go, watch this, because holding on to it prevents me from getting what God has for me. And you can shout about what God has for me, it is for me, all you want. But the true fact is that if I don't learn how to forgive, the devil ain't blocking my blessing, you are. When it is, I learn how to balance between what my unforgiving soul wants to do and what my faithfulness wants to do, then I got to trust God that when I forgive, it increases my faith in God. When I forgive, it enhances my relationship with God. And the Bible says that it is at the moment of forgiveness that God turns some things around. I wish somebody, I know you in your living room, I know you at work, I know you ain't supposed to be watching, but I dare you in the spirit, even right now, to just get up and turn around one time. I dare you to just, I see you, put your robe on, but turn around one good time. Why? Because what I'm believing God for is the moment you forgive the person you've been holding accountable, that's the moment God is about to turn your captivity. Listen to this. Captivity means you've been enslaved. Might I ask you the question, what has enslaved you? What situation have you allowed to keep you held in bondage? What situation have you allowed to hinder you from going where God wants you to go? He says that he turned the captivity of Job. Watch this. When Job prayed for his friends. Y'all missed it. Here's what you ought to shout about. You ought to shout because you've either been the friend who's had to pray for somebody else, or you've been the friend who's been prayed for. Either way, you ought to say thank you for being a friend. I wish somebody would type that even right now. I got some people I got to thank for being a friend. Watch this. Sometimes if it wasn't for those friends that left you hanging, you would have never got what God had for you. If it wasn't for those friends who lied on you, you never would have lost everything so that you can gain more than you ever had. The Bible says that God gave Job twice as much as he had before. And that's why you got to thank God, because not only do you have to deal with unfortunate facts, not only do you have to deal with unfortunate, unfiltered family and friends, not only do you have to go between unforgiveness and faith, but you got to thank God because he is an unfailing father. Thank God that even when I have failed him, God never failed me. Is there anybody that can praise God even on a Sunday morning that even when I have failed God, God never fails me? Now that is what a true friend is. That is what a true friend does. God, and he shows us what true friendships look like. Because while we were yet in sin, yes, I'm almost ready. It says that Christ died for the ungodly. Listen to this. The Bible says that no greater love than this, than a man that would lay down his life, yeah, for his friend. And I know there's somebody who's watching that you may not feel like you have other friends that you can thank God for. I know you might not have a whole lot of people that you're connected to, but you ought to thank God because theirs, yes, not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Yes, no, not one. None else can heal all my soul's diseases. No, not one. Is there anybody that can go on and help me put a little fire on this thing? Is there anybody that can give God glory and give God praise? Because the songwriter says, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, yes, our sins and griefs to bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Is there anybody here that can say, have we found a friend so faithful who in all our sorrows share? Somebody here ought to give God glory and give God praise because he is a friend. You ought to say, thank you for being a friend. Travel down the road and back again. Your heart is true. You're a pal and a confidant. And if you threw a party, you invited everyone you knew. And you would see the biggest gift would be for me. And the card attached would say, thank you for being a friend. Somebody watching ought to lift up your hands and tell the Lord, Lord, I thank you for being a friend. Thank you that you're a friend that's sticking closer than a brother. I really want to thank you because, God, you've been good to me, been better to me than I've been to myself. So that's why I can praise God, because God is about to give you double, yes, for your trouble. Ain't you worthy to give God praise even right now in the midst of your pain? You ought to praise God that God is turning it around. He's turning your finances around. He's turning your friendships around. He's turning your family around. God will. I said, won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he turn it around? And when God does it, you ought to say, thank you for being my friend. I dare somebody who's on the verge of giving up to give God the best praise that you can give. Because double is on the way. More blessings are on the way. They're going to overtake you. Because God is faithful. Ain't he faithful? He is faithful. And just to forgive you, you ought to give God praise. Because my friend, it was hung on an old rugged cross. They put nails in his hands, put nails in his feet, pierced him in the side, put a crown of thorns on his head. My friend died, didn't he die? But before he died, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that's why I can be a witness that God sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him won't perish, but have everlasting life. You gotta believe he died, but he didn't stay dead. Because bright and early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. You ought to tell him thank you. Give God praise. I said, give God glory. Let everything that's got breath give God praise. Come on and give him glory even now. Give him glory even now. Listen, if you are watching right now and you don't know that the Lord has given you a friend that's sticking closer than a brother, his name is Jesus. Yeah, I know your friendships have gone. I know you've had some people that you trusted. I know you have some people that have left you hanging and let some things happen in your life. But listen to this. I've come to declare right now that there's not a friend like Jesus. If you're watching today and you don't have a relationship with this Jesus, while the Spirit of God is moving right now, if you really want to thank him for being a friend, you ought to give him your life today. You ought to move right now while the Spirit of God is moving, because there's not a friend like Jesus. If you don't have a relationship right now, you can just simply say this prayer. Just say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I confess that I am a sinner that needs to be saved by your grace. I believe that you died on the cross, rose on the third day with all power in your hands. Come into my heart, and my life will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen to this. If you're watching right now and you have prayed this prayer, we're believing by faith that you are now a part of God's family of faith. Listen, it's time to give now as the Lord has blessed you, man. I'm excited about what God is going to do on your behalf. Now, listen to this. You cannot hear this word about God giving you double for your trouble and give minimal. No, you got to give like you know double is on the way. You got to give like you know twice as much is on the way. And so as you prepare your gift, I want you to sow into this ministry. Why? Because you are growing through this ministry. If you are increasing your faith, if God is stretching your belief, I want you to give today like you've never given before. I know that that what God has just spoken to you seems like a bit much, but I want you to give what God just placed on your heart even right now. If you are giving, I want you to know through Cash App, we have our Cash App account, which is $TheTabernacleUC. $TheTabernacle, the letter U and the letter C. I want you to give abundantly, knowing God's about to give you double for your trouble. Listen, we are excited about what God is doing right here at the Tabernacle. Every week, I want you to tune in. On Monday nights, we have our Monday night manna at 6:30. So I want you to make sure you tune in on Monday nights for Monday night manna. And then I want you to also tune in every Sunday for our Sunday Night Fire. Now listen to this, beginning next week, Sunday Night Fire will only be broadcast at 6:30. We will not be broadcasting at 12. We will broadcast at 6:30. So I want you to make sure you mark your calendar, do whatever you got to do on Sunday, but make sure at 6:30 Eastern Standard Time, you are here for Sunday Night Fire, because it's going to be fire. I am excited about what God is going to do on your behalf. We're grateful for you tuning in. Make sure you share right now. Make sure you click that share button and watch how God blesses you and your friends that you're connected to. I dare somebody to call your friends right now. I dare you to send them a text right now and simply say thank you for being a friend. My name is Pastor Richard Holman. Remember, I love you. There's nothing you can do about it. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer.